Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mark DiCarlo, and tonight my guest is Mark Scott, city councilman for what?
16 at large? Years? Oh, yeah, many years. 12, I think.
12 years? And now at large. How did you get away with that? Isn't there like a term limit, Steve?
There was. At the time, there was an 8-year term limit. I sat out for 2 years. I was really uncomfortable with what I thought the direction was going in the during that time I was off the council, and thought I'd try to do something about it. So I was a District 4 rep for 8 years, sat out. Now I'm an at-large, and I've enjoyed being an at-large.
So 12 years, and you would have started somewhere like, when what would that
99.
Have been?
99. I was elected in the spring of 99.
Okay.
Well, the you direction know what, 10, 11 years, yeah.
Yeah, the direction the city's going in. And I wasn't going to bring this up first, but this is the way the show goes. Man, a lot of people aren't happy. And I make jokes with people. You know, I say, look, Corpus Christi has become a big slum. Yeah. You know what? I hear a certain amount of agreement with that. What do you think? I mean, do you think that we're as in bad, you know, that we are going backwards? Do you think that the city's doing great? Do you think something like that is just uncalled for to say?
Yeah, I think actually I would disagree on your first premise.
Okay.
I think the sense is that things are going better. I don't know that well, and I don't even know if you get to this term that you want to call it well. You want to always try
well,
to
I mean,
improve, but I think people are are feeling good about the city. I think that there's a sense of opportunity. You know, our education system is in much better shape than
because
it was
of
5 years
ago.
No, because I'm talking about public ed. Scott Ellick, predominantly. I mean, that they have changed some things in public education that have gotten given people a sense that that it's improving.
The what have they changed?
The International Baccalaureate Program would be one. That is an internationally recognized curriculum, so that when we're out recruiting executives, not we, but you know, like Citco out trying to get executives, they can now look at our public education system and find a niche for their kids if they want them to be in the most challenging.
Okay.
But
so
that's really a conversation for CCISD. But my sense is that people see that that's improving. Our higher education system is getting better and is growing.
Unemployment is for compared to the rest of the country is doing very well. I would agree with you there.
Right.
I think
maybe the streets issue is what's kind of bringing people
and
down.
Well, you know, the street issue I don't quite get because I can speak anecdotally from personal experience. I remember when I had run for city council 15 years ago, just once, I said, look, you need to fix the street, you need to pick up the trash, and you need to, you know, you need to take care of the basic services. Well, it seemed like that political call got picked up for a couple runs by the politicians. And then I'd heard a lot about it, but nonetheless, it still doesn't
seem to have
improved.
We have invested $150 million in streets in the last 10 years, which is really profound. So, you know, everywhere you drive, driving down today, coming over here, there were, you know, road construction signs up. So I think we're making a difference. The real problem is people say we have $1 billion to fix it all, and we can't ever get there, so things are bad. I would submit to you that there is no city in America that has a financial system in place today to replace all of their streets in a 20 to 30 year life cycle. In other words, we're not any different really than the rest of the country with one exception. And that is we didn't do anything to improve our streets from 1984 to 2000. And that 16 year gap really put us behind the curve. But since then we had a $30 million street package. We had a $70 million package. And then the council I was not on passed that $120 million package. So.
Well, I think there's other issues too. I think we have a big dog problem issue, right? You see,
I would submit to you that we have, and the city manager will tell you that we have underfunded that part of our city for a couple of years. In fact, in this current budget cycle, we put more money into that department.
And I happened to be in court one day, and I saw some of the guys. Well, I better not say. Okay. My understanding is that there's only two people picking up dogs or something.
I would not know that. That's not.
Okay,
that's really not
okay.
My cup of tea.
All right, and I think people complain about that. And the other thing I think that we have a lot of complaints about is just your basic enforcement of ordinances and standards.
Code enforcement.
Right, code enforcement is terrible. I think maybe that's wherein I'd heard there was only two people enforcing, you know, building codes, et cetera.
Well, and that's the other area in this current budget that we put more money in. When Ron Olson, our new city manager, came on in, April, he looked at the situation, came to us and said, look, there are two areas we got to improve today. And mostly it's a money issue. We need more bodies. We need more people picking up the animals, and we need more people in code enforcement. So we recognize that, and when there are more people doing that business today than there were 6 months ago, what I can't tell you is that the right number? You know, have we reached the right amount of, have we put in the right amount of assets at work in there? Because that's really not stuff I get, it's just, you know, I'm not involved in that on a day-to-day basis. But we are trying to make improvements, and we've add additional funds to it.
And I will tell you, based upon anecdotal experience too, that I have heard, you know, I know some lawyers in my approximate age group that actually have left town because they felt disappointed in what they feel is the whatever, what would that be, social, cultural,
I think that's milieu true. Here, especially a younger, I don't know how to define younger anymore, but there's not a lot of social opportunity, a lot of things for younger people to do. I think there are more today than there was yesterday.
Well, you know, though, I have witnessed, now this is going to make me sound like a Scrooge, but I've seen all this money put into parks, and I'm thinking to myself, with all these little parks that they put up for children, I'm thinking to myself, does our city never watch TV? Do they never see how soda pop is marketed? It's not. Do they not see how everything is marketed towards sexuality and towards young people and towards excitement and glamour, and then we're marketing it like, hey, you know.
Right. Well,
and I don't know. That is just an impression. It's not really. Maybe I shouldn't even have thrown that out.
Well, because we actually, a couple things. One, when I was growing up, the worst thing you could do to a park was put equipment on it. You know.
Right.
But I'm a different era. I mean, we threw four tennis shoes and declared out our football field, and we played for you know hours. But we have recognized that the pocket parks aren't working, and we are working through a system to reduce the number of pocket parks, just because there are not a lot of kids use them anymore, and go to more regional area parks and try to make improvements there. We've privatized some of the park maintenance in the last 8 months, 9 months, and that's gone well. And we may privatize some more of that in the next 12 months. We're just trying to get our dollars to go farther.
That was something that you had advertised in the Corpus Christi, advertised. You had stated in the Corpus Christi Caller Times, at least they quoted you, we've made great strides in the privatization of city services, and we need to ratchet up our efforts there.
I believe that. We privatized some of the park maintenance, predominantly the downtown stuff and shoreline, and we think that's really working. We privatized the golf course maintenance, which has really been a home run. I mean, it's really been fascinating to watch how people have responded to our golf courses now that Forsyth Golf has come in and take over maintenance. I think that tells us something. Now, I'll tell you what. The original concept was privatization. You know, if it's in the yellow pages, let the private sector do it. You know, if that service is out there. That has kind of morphed into a concept called, not privatization, but managed competition. And we stole a concept out of Carrollton up around the Dallas area, where they came in, they looked at departments, and the simple math was, You kind of get your staff, say, how much does it cost per ton to pick up the trash? Then you pick up the phone and you call BFI and say, hey guys, what do y'all charge? And if it's a big difference, you put it out for bid. But you let your staff bid it also. And at the end of the day, if they have a better bid package, you award it internally, but they still sign an employment agreement or an expectation similar to the private sector. But as long as they can do it, it's fine. We did that to a couple things successfully. Most recently, though, we looked at our IT department and our fleet maintenance. And during that experience, we found that it's really cheaper to keep it in-house. And so, in other words, we're not automatically pushing stuff out to the private sector, but we are looking for ways to do more with less.
The biggest complaints about privatization that you hear about from the left or progressives is that you have perhaps a city service or a utility that was built up through years of taxpayers putting money into it and they've owned it, etc. And then when you privatize it, somebody, some businessman just comes in to make this profit after years of what the
right, making profit off of our assets,
yes.
You're my taxpayer office.
Yes.
Well, and that's one of the probably the reasons we haven't really looked into privatizing or selling our gas department that has come up occasionally. That would be one. You could get a big chunk of cash today, but I think you would wake up 20 years from now and regret that you got rid of that department. So I hear that. Most of what we're talking about is, you know, how do we manage the assets we have? We're not selling the asset, but, you know, for instance, fleet maintenance. Do we want to hire a staff to take care of maintaining our fleet, or do we want to contract, you know, with the car loan associates to manage our fleet? And I think that's a good thought process. And again, in that example, by the way, we kept it internally.
It sounds like a lot of what you're talking about, though, you don't have a lot of hard, whatever physical assets built up in some of this stuff anyway. So you could.
The basis, though, is, you know, there is a reasonable expectation by our customers, our rate payers, our voters, that we do the best we can at spending our money wisely. And again, if we reached out and we could find a way to do it privately that was much cheaper than doing it the way we do now, then we owe it to you, the taxpayer, to at least look at that. We've done that a couple times, and a couple of times we said, no, we're going to keep it in.
I think that one of the issues that, and I'm not accusing the present city council of any corruption or anything, but I think one of the issues is that, you know, once you have that kind of money that is going out, you're afraid that, you know, well, it's going up for contracts. What if a contractor gets to the city councilman and they're running for campaigns? Like, I didn't investigate, for example, how much it costs. Like, what did you have to pay last time? How much did it cost you to run for city council at large last time?
$75,000.
Yeah.
I think that's about the number.
So that's a lot of money
to
most people.
That's a lot of money to me.
But that's at large. I guess it's somewhat more than if you run in your district.
The first time I ran for District 4, there were three candidates, and we all spent between $60,000 and $80,000 apiece. So it's a lot of money. So I get that. You could say,
you're running. You need all this money to run. You're bidding out these contracts. And then, you know, if any of these people have a possible conflict or something, they could, you know, they're donating to whoever, Mark Scott, whoever's running.
I get that.
So that's one of the issues, right?
Well, we've got a pretty good check and balance system on our from our purchasing department. We rarely get, you know, not accused or criticized for those kind of decisions. We think we've got a pretty good system in place to protect the public, that kind of stuff.
I put on the internet, I said to a friend of mine that's politically active, I said, look, I got Mark Scott coming up. You got a question for him. So
bring
you want to hear the question?
Let's
and it's related to the conflict.
Sure.
I don't know that much about the Las Brisas conflict, Las Brisas project.
Oh, yeah.
I've kind of said, look, I don't know much about it. I'm in favor of it. I haven't studied it, so my opinion's not worth much more than anybody else's. I've had a lot of people on. I'm kind of in favor of it. Why? Well, they say it'll lower energy. They say it'll bring some jobs. I don't know. But he said, well, ask him why he voted for the Las Brisas water contract 4 weeks after San Jacinto Title issued a title commitment for Las Brisas from the port.
A couple things. One, because they told me we weren't doing the business. And they told me that it was actually 8 weeks between that last commitment and our vote. And then I confirmed it the week of and then the day of, because I don't purposely go out of my way to get beat up. It's not fun for people to call me bad names. And
we're not doing that.
The people that sent that probably did. You could read the blogs. I'm not accusing you, but my point
is, I didn't even know that.
I didn't, it would have been really much easier for me to abstain, but they looked me in the eye and said, Mark, you're not doing this. You're not doing our business. We've told you you're not closing this. You don't have a conflict. You have to vote. And we know, because you've told us, that you're going to vote for it. So in other words, I thought, man, you know what? I'm just going to abstain, and then I don't have to deal with the pain and agony with the vote.
Right.
But that would not have been appropriate, because they had told me in no uncertain terms that we weren't doing their title work. And just so you know.
But you are.
We are not. No.
Okay, so you're not.
No. We haven't spoken to them since March of 2009.
How much title work would there be?
Oh, there'd be a big title pending. It's all based on dollars. And so if they borrow a whole bunch of money, that's a big title policy.
Okay, so the Las Brisas water contract, they're going to buy this physical plant, and when the physical plant is purchased, then there's a big title policy.
Right, and that was the other issue, by the way. There was no it wasn't like I got a bunch of title insurance based on this water contract. So even, you know, I went to our, by the way, I went to the city attorney on several occasions to see if there were conflicts of interest. You know, I have an opinion for him that says there's not. So, by the way, I don't think it's ever going to happen, frankly, because I think it was all based on the price of gas. And I think Eagleford Shell has kind of made that point, made that project move.
I see. Well,
because they were cheaper than gas. I'm sorry to interrupt you. But if gas is selling at $12 a BCF and they can produce, you know, coal, petroleum coke at 6 cents as opposed to 12 cents, it works. But when gas came down to $3 and $4 a BCF, it really threw their financial packaging.
But prior to that, you were favored the Las Brisas project.
I still do. I think that it's good for number one. Well, we can talk about it.
Well, I'm
for a variety of reasons.
Well, let me ask you this. Yeah, why did you favor it? Because most of the people that I've had on this public access show have been against it, and they stated, for example, that it brings too much pollution for the amount of jobs that it would bring in. That's the basic reason. And then it was untrue that it would reduce the price of electricity locally because it would just basically be sold on the grid. So how would you? Why are you in favor of the? Why were you in favor?
Let me just first tell you what the city did and how important it is what we did. We voted to sell somebody water should they receive all the appropriate permits. That's a big deal because that's a signal to the community. If we had voted against selling somebody water that got all the appropriate permits, who would ever want to come to Corpus? If the next big project came to Corpus and had to go through a lot of permitting, why would they even want to invest, you know, the millions it takes to even start the project? Because we might, what we would do is we would say, you know, even if you're permitted, we don't like you. We're not selling you water. Now, by the way, our contract with the state of Texas doesn't allow us to do that. Our contract with the state of Texas requires us to sell water to anyone that's properly permitted. So if we'd have voted against that contract, we could have been sued and would have lost. That's my opinion. So take the whole environmental issue aside, we technically are required by law to sell water. So it's really a moot point. My opinion, first of all, my opinion of the environment, I think is moot because I think that I am required as a council member to sell water to anybody's permitted.
Well, that's a good angle. Nobody's addressed. I've never heard that before.
I said it often during that, but it got beat up.
So what you're saying is it only had to do with water rights? It doesn't have to do with any other kind of zoning or whatever that you had okay?
Nope. Mm-mm. All we committed to do was to sell a company water. Should they? And we did it early. So we said, you know what, guys? Go fight your environmental fights. That's between you and the TCEQ, the EPAs.
Well, why did you do it early? Why didn't you wait? Well, you didn't. Why didn't you wait until after they got all the permits and that? Because it
was moot, and we could now send a message. We sent a message to America that if you want to come to Corpus, we'll sell you water, subject to all your permits. We didn't, you know. So we did it early, so we wouldn't worry about the rest of it. Let them go fight their EPA. And by the way, if you read the TCEQ, it's got some interesting comments. I think they have, people have misstated the TCEQ's position on the Las Brisas stuff.
Well, I mean, you got the guys on public access with this. As a matter of fact, I see one at the meeting all the time, one guy, you know, the professor at Del Mar, I won't give him his name, and he's no Las Brisas and all that. Like, it's a real important thing, you know, is it?
And to us at the city, what we did was,
and the doctors
like
dug in.
Right.
I mean, you know, you never heard the doctors for years politically.
It's a big deal.
Anything. And now they're saying they're, you know.
But you know, and I look, I'm a businessman, and I'm happy to be able to do my ABCs. I'm not the smartest guy in the room, but it's interesting because we used a guy out of Texas A&M Kingsville for years. Everybody acknowledged him as the genius in the room, especially when he was beating up industry. He analyzed that and said, you know what? It's not a bad deal. You ought to give him a permit. Well, then he was the Antichrist. Dr. John's his name. He eventually moved to another university, but Dr. John did all the work for, and it didn't do it for Las Brisas. He did it for the city and some other entity, and he goes, look, I'm the genius in the room. You've told me I've got all the PhDs. I've done the data. I think they ought to get a permit.
Well, you know, I would probably be termed, because I think all these liberal and conservative labels no longer work, but I guess a lot of people might stereotype me as being on the left or something. But, you know, I just couldn't see that, you know, if, again, I believe in regulation, right, and appropriate regulation. And as long as a place was appropriately regulated and there was no corruption in the regulations,
right,
it probably was going to be a good thing. And of course,
but we all need to acknowledge it was not the cleanest industry around. I mean, everybody needs to know it was not, you know, they weren't making water. There were plenty of pollutants that they were going to pump
into the air. And many people who expressed the, what's the name of the Chinese pipeline company?
TPCO.
Yeah, a lot of what I think of as moderate and intelligent people said, well, look, that one is fine. That pipeline project is fine. But the Las Brisas is no good.
Well, and they did a horrible job. Las Brisas did a horrible job at engaging the community early on in the conversation. Their public affairs was atrocious. You know, I think that they, and that's probably one of the reasons why I haven't spoken to them in 20-something months. They just figured, you know, all I got to do is get, you know, I got to get what I got to get, and I'm going to get out of town, and I'm going to worry about that fight. As opposed to companies like Cheniere Energy, who was at one time working on a LNG project. They came in, they said, let me tell you what we're thinking about, let me bring you in, what are your concerns? I can't address them all, but here's the ones I can. You know, they brought people to the table. People said, I'm worried about some erosion issues. They made investments in erosion issues. They did it right, as opposed to Las Brisas, who just kind of blew through it.
Yeah,
I'm very critical of how they went about it.
I don't know. Is that what you're required to do now? You got to be a big PR guy?
I think so. Assets. You know, I mean, they would buy a ton of water.
There was another company that came in that didn't get any kind. I don't know how big it's going to be, but some sort of was it an Italian company making plastics?
Oh, yeah,
something?
They're still around, M&G.
Yeah, and they haven't received that kind of bad publicity either.
They haven't filed an air permit yet. I don't think that they kick out the pollutants that Las Brisas did. Las Brisas was significant. That their pollutants numbers were significant, and I don't want to not say that. Would probably be more than any others.
Yeah, more significant than most.
Right.
Most industries.
Yes.
Gonna be.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's.
But in the end, that's why. So I had my city attorney said I didn't have a conflict. They looked me in the eye and said, you can only have a conflict, you got to vote. And
but you know, when I was more active in city politics and all, I had thought the city attorney was being misused by issuing like judicial opinions to rubber stamp what politicians wanted
Could
to
be.
Do.
I hear what you're saying. I went to him and said, hey, I need you to write me an opinion.
And then they write this opinion, and then I'm saying, well, look, oh, that's all fine and good, but you know, you're just justifying, you work for the city, you're justifying the opinions. And, you know, and then, okay, and then I'm over there when I was with Joe O'Brien, more of the taxpayers, okay, that's fine.
I understand.
You know what I'm saying?
I get the criticism.
And I don't even know who's the city attorney now?
Carlos Valdez.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Carlos isn't afraid to tell you what he's thinking. I don't think he's a rubber stamp guy.
No, well, Carlos Valdez, you just had us a little bit of an issue regarding this road, what was it, the aquarium?
Aquarius? Oh, I still think Carlos was right on that.
Well, I don't know the issues that well on the Aquarius Street issues. I just know that an ex-city councilman and attorney, Mr. Mike Hummel, accepted this case and stated that this road on Padre Island was not in conformity with what the voters wanted.
I think it was. I think it is. Do you realize if we go back to the location he wants, it will add as much as 3 minutes in emergency response time? If you're having a heart attack on the other side of that road and it takes us three more minutes to get there, shame on somebody. I think the road did comply. I think it does comply. I'm disappointed in the outcome. Again, I'm not a lawyer, but I do think we were trying to do the right thing. I think it was a good project. I don't know where we go from here on that. We did, by the way, what gets lost in that is we received a declaratory judgment on everything else associated with Bond 08. So, you know, what gets lost in that battle is we realized that we needed to get some direction from the court on the rest of the projects we're doing, or else we would be sued. You know, that same theory, you could say, Mark, you know, I voted for the street like this, and you added 2 feet, or that's the same legal theory, and we could be sued on every one of our projects. We went to the judge, He gave us a ruling that freed us up to move forward, which, by the way, frees up the bridge on Park Road 22.
Well, there was a man who I thought was kind of funny what he said, and it was the only thing that I could figure out, because I wasn't going to spend hours reading this stuff.
Oh, the all I wanted was stop Barabino. Lights.
And yeah. So, you know, all we wanted was some speed bumps and stop signs.
I don't think that's the case, personally.
And you know why I thought
that
was funny?
But you wouldn't want speed humps on Santa Fe.
And I wouldn't want them maybe on Elizabeth Street.
Right.
But you want them on your residential street.
And it's not, it is a...
This was a residential street.
No, it's a, what? There's a middle one, a collector street. It's not a residential street. It's the second, it's the next grade up.
So why did they want speed bumps and stop signs if it wasn't a residential street? Why'd they want those?
You'll have to ask him. We were always going to put, I think, at least one stop sign. And what's interesting, by the way, is the design that Mr. Barabino wants basically creates a quarter mile drag strip. It is a straight road for maybe a half a mile. And the concept we came up working with all the Islanders was to bring that section in a curve, which would slow traffic down. Yeah. We had medians to slow traffic down. And then it teed in with the fire station so that when there would be a call, they would go right out their station, right on that road on their way to, you know, helping people.
You know, this is off point, and it may be unfair to say, but I'm thinking to myself, who's coming up with all this money to be paying this attorney?
Well, I think Mike
to file
did
this
it.
Suit.
Mike just did
and
it
I'm talking. Time. Listen, if somebody came in my office, I don't know, I don't do that kind of law, and it would. So you might have to give me an inducement, but I mean, I'm not involving myself in complex litigation wherein I can't win any money for less than $10,000.
Right, right.
So somebody funded some major suit there.
You know, I don't know.
I don't know. So somebody was very, very up in arms.
Barabino had his own lawyer. Mr. Hummel actually represented himself. He was a plaintiff in the case.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he was not.
What was his standing to be the plaintiff?
That he was a taxpayer. He doesn't live on the island.
Did they challenge his standing, his legal standing?
I don't think we did. I don't think we did. I don't know what's going
to
happen.
Tell Carlos to get on the stick, man.
Well,
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, I know. But there's
maybe
it's going to be an interesting conversation next couple of weeks, because that ruling is unique in the state of Texas.
Okay, I'm going to say, you know, I don't know if you've seen the show very often, but I say some controversial things sometimes. I think the Court of Appeals trying to sue the city and getting it upheld and winning and getting it held by the Court of Appeals isn't easy in this town.
I would agree.
And so, I don't know.
We've won many appeals over the years.
And I got to say that I don't necessarily, I've seen before where I totally disagreed with that Court of Appeals. Mm. And I think that, unfortunately, I think a lot of times, again, and courts have it, historically, people think that they do this. They sometimes rubber stamp on the side of the status quo and on the power base. So,
see, I don't know. I don't have any relationship with appeals. I just kind of going off of lawyers, and I talk to
them. I've been up there.
Yeah, see, I wouldn't.
I've been up there and that sort of thing. So, but it was kind of interesting the amount of publicity that issue got. But how much money was on the table? How big a project is this? What was involved?
$2 million.
$2 million seems like a lot for a street.
Maybe that includes, I think it was $2 million. That includes infrastructure. Remember, when we build a street, you spend a dollar on the street and you spend a dollar underneath it with utilities. But there were two issues on the island at the same time. One's Aquarius and one's the bridge on Park Road 22. If you listen to the Schlitterbahn folks, that bridge is very important to them. And so we wanted to do some things to protect our decision. And what gets lost in the mix this week is that the judge ruled in our favor on that issue. So that does give...
The issue of Schlitterbahn, I'm sorry.
Yeah, Schlitterbahn wants to build a resort, a water park and resort on about 500 acres.
So is that going to be as big as the one that's in...
I think it's bigger. But okay. The park won't be bigger. What Schlitterbahn was telling us is that, you know, we can build a park anywhere. Really can. They get calls every week.
And Schlitterbahn, for the people who don't know, it's like a water park, a water amusement park of some sort, right?
Right. And it's family owned. They're out of New Braunfels, Texas. They've got parks in New Braunfels, South Padre Island, Galveston, and then they put one in Kansas City. They're looking at projects in Cedar Park. That's important. We'll come back to that. Fort Lauderdale, Florida, and then Corpus Christi. And our attempt is to slide ahead of Cedar Park and Fort Lauderdale. And the reason why Cedar Park's important is the project will require incentives, and I don't think anybody's not said that. And we expect their request in the next couple weeks. But we know what Cedar Park gave them.
And when you say by incentives, you obviously mean that they're not going to pay any taxes or lowered taxes,
right,
property taxes, et cetera, for a certain period of time, right?
Right? I think it will. Well, let me tell you what Cedar Park gave them. Cedar Park gave them cash. The day they opened, they got X amount of money. And then a year later, they got X amount of money. And then they did that to offset some of their, you know, overall costs. And then they got a percentage of whatever tax revenue they created, they got back. And the reason why we like that one is, hey, you don't build a building, we're not giving you anything. If you build a building that generates $1 million in taxes, we'll give you $400,000 back. And I'm making that up. But the good concept there is, we only give you a portion of what you create. We're not giving you something if you don't do something. So anyhow, we know what Cedar Park gave them, and we'll get their request in a couple weeks. And if we meet that request, then they're going to have to go through some zoning issues because it's a special project. Then they're going to have to finance it, which is out of our control. But I do think they can make it work. It's family-owned. They're committed. They're really good at what they
do. I had been under the impression that all these incentives that these cities and states were giving were relatively new. And then I had been visiting my father in Ohio in this small industrial town. I don't want to say too much, you know, about my own background. What difference does it make? But I had seen around 1900 this. It was an industrial town. They had given a big tax incentive to a company by the name of Diebold's to come in back then,
yeah,
to a German company.
Oh, yeah.
So apparently, yeah, this is nothing new. I don't know philosophically if I agree with it totally. I mean, I guess it depends upon how it's administered,
well,
and all, but you know.
At the end of the day, it doesn't, and I don't mean to be crass about this, but it really doesn't matter what you and I think.
Right.
Because I don't want to give away money.
Right.
That's just what it takes. And if you don't want, if you don't play the game,
well,
you have no chance.
And it's not
projects.
A good game.
Right.
And
right.
I wonder even sometimes.
And you know, a dollar today is a dollar ten tomorrow. You know, if you commit to a dollar, the next city is going to give them a dollar ten. So it's
but
game.
What it's really gotten, that's not so egregious like a Schlitter bond, but these companies that kind of go on the market and then move from place to place. Getting,
right.
I tell you who I think, now I don't know, I hate to say this about a personal company, is Apex still here?
Yes.
Okay. I had thought they had downsized.
They did, and they got a big project, and they ramped back up.
So they ramped back up. But I do know, again, in that area that I'm from, one of those telephone solicitation companies, it seems like they have a tendency to go where they get some pretty big tax incentives and then kind of move off.
Right. The thing about Schlitterbahn, frankly, is that anybody you talk to says, you know, it's not so much about the water slide. It's about all the people that come from everywhere, mm-hmm, and
they have a big capital investment.
They shop everywhere.
They have a big capital investment. It's not like a phone bank where they're just renting office space and they can take off.
I bet you'll see that phase one will be $35 to $50 million. But keep in mind, this is what Schlitterbahn will tell you is the mistakes they've made in the past is they've gone and they bought a little tract of land and then they were highly successful and then everybody around them made all their money. So the reason they like this Corpus,
right?
So the reason I like Corpus is it's 500 acres, so that they can participate in all the good stuff that happens around that water. Now, I think you'll see, by the way, that the Corpus project will be low profile. You're not going to see any 5-story rides with, you know, lights and, you know, flashing, because it is, they're looking at taking over the Padre Island Country Club, which is close to a residential area.
And so what's Padre Island Country Club going to close?
Yeah.
And why are so many of the country clubs closing? Didn't we have King's Crossing Country Club close, and now this one? Why are they?
Fair Oaks closed. King's Crossing's closed. Newport Dunes, which is in Port Aransas, is in bankruptcy. And then Padre Isles is having a difficult time. You know, golf all over the country is waning.
Is it?
It really is. And just in itself, golf is not doing well. But golf, with a lot of additional cost associated with it, is doing even worse. The golf courses that are doing well now or a golf course with a, you know, a little building that sells hamburgers, you know, not country club environments with a lot of overhead. So
yeah, I live right outside of the Corpus Christi Country Club there.
Right, okay.
I assume
they're still doing well.
I would have thought they're going to be doing better because these other ones are closing. I don't
think that
it's true.
It is true.
But and that one's pretty well located, essentially located.
Right.
But you know what I wonder? I mean, this is gossip. It doesn't make any difference. But I just think people don't have the time to golf, do they?
I don't think so. I think we're all working a little bit harder just because of the economy.
I mean, I couldn't imagine, I'm going to go spend all day, you know, golf. I couldn't imagine it.
The other thing that's hurt country club environments is, all the restaurants. You know, there's a lot more competition for dinner.
Yeah,
you know, everybody wants to go to Macaroni Grill as opposed to the country club.
It's a lot easier to get in and out of Macaroni Grill than it is to get in and out of.
So the good news is though that we don't want Padre Isles Country Club to just simply close and end up looking like King's Crossing or Faro Valley. If we can redevelop that property, maintain some golf as buffer, and that's what the concept is to keep nine holes between the Schlitterbahn and the subdivision, use that as buffer, then there's still golf. There'll be a lot more people coming. I tell you what's interesting, I ran into a fishing guide the other day, and that is all he wanted to talk about. Because he gets it, Schlitterbahn is everything to those guys, because families will come to town, dad will go fishing, mom will take the kids to go play in the park, or mom and dad will go fishing. And that's what's interesting about this Schlitterbahn experience. I was in Rockport the other day. That's all they wanted to talk about. Because
is
just because Port Aransas sees this as potentially another night in their hotels.
Oh, Port Aransas, let me say this. I don't get over there much, but I don't know how they're going great. Guys.
They are doing well. They're doing very well.
I mean, could you believe the property values over there?
Yeah.
Man, I could have been a rich guy, you know.
If we only knew what we know now.
Well, and they've held up, unlike these other boom towns in Florida, et cetera.
Right.
I mean, they've held up very well. I don't think...
They've held up well. Cinnamon Shore's doing very well over there. Newport Dunes has struggled. That's in bankruptcy now. That's the new golf course and the subdivision around it. And that's pretty rocky.
There. That's in Port A?
Yeah.
You mentioned about King. You don't want it looking like King's Crossing.
Mm-hmm.
What's King's Crossing? What's King's Crossing? What does it look like?
It's King's Crossing Country Club, the golf course, and it's just brushland. And the sidewalks have not been maintained, so they're all broken up.
Mm-hmm. What are they talking about doing it? That this large country club that closed up, that sold all these houses around it.
All those property values went down 10%. I think
10% is not too bad.
Right. Well, it's bad if you're the city.
But this is pretty far south. You know, I hate to say this too. It sounds so elitist or something. But, you know, when I go out that far to the south side and it's flat and there's no water... And man, if there ain't no country club, you know, it doesn't look, not too great, you know.
I don't know. At the end of the day, if homeowners look for schools,
well, that's probably true.
And those schools out there are pretty well recognized.
So what are they going to do with this big empty lot? Who owns it? What has been talked about? I read some controversy where they were talking about putting apartments up there, and the local homeowners were against it.
Yeah, it's owned by a gentleman who lives, I think, in Minnesota now. And I don't think there's any plans to do anything about it now. As opposed to Faro Valley, now that closed, and a gentleman who lives close to here named Jim Charnquist, who's an apartment developer. He's built 40,000 units in his lifetime. They're very successful. He has made an offer to come in and buy the course, build some apartments on Ennis Joslyn, keep the wetland areas as some sort of park, maybe even a private park to the homeowners or a public park. And then go in the back area and build single-family residences. So that one's a little further on than King's Crossing. The problem with Faro Valley is it's deed restricted. You can't build anything but a golf course unless you get 70 to 75% of the homeowners around the course to agree to lift that deed restriction. So it's
that could be a tough deal.
That's a tough deal. I went to that town hall meeting, and that was brutal. That was really brutal.
Well, they're paying tax. I mean, whoever owns King's Crossing is paying taxes on all this land, right?
Yeah, yes, but he's written it way down because it's non-functioning, so it's not on. I don't know what it is, but it can't be on the rolls for the same amount.
I could believe that, but between the taxes and then just keeping it cut, I mean, well, you think I don't there'd think be a huge incentive yeah, to...
I don't think he maintains it. I don't think it's maintained. I don't really know.
Start giving the zone. Start writing out the tickets.
Yeah, there's your...
there's your zone.
There's my code enforcement guys. Yeah, I don't... I'm not that close. Larry Elizondo, Councilman Elizondo's been close. Looking for ways to try to save that.
Well, I'm kind of surprised because I thought when the Ingleside base closed, I thought to myself, I said, this is going to probably be better in many respects in the long run, and it appears that it might work out that way.
We'll see. Tuesday's the vote. They
is
vote.
Right?
They vote. I went to the presentation this week. Canyonport has a contract that will be on the Port Commissioner's agenda Tuesday.
So I thought maybe in a similar manner, if you had a large developed area, maybe like a country club, in the long run, perhaps it could work out to be better. But
well, I think redeveloping that course is problematic. It's just problematic. Golf courses are tough to redevelop
because they're built up and all.
Well, they basically serve as stormwater. You know, they're really kind of stormwater ditches. You know, that they're designed to collect water.
I didn't know that. That's very interesting.
To collect water, move it through to some of their lakes, and then use that water. So if you come in and develop it, not only do you have your setbacks from side to side, you know, if you have got to put all this infrastructure underground that you don't normally have, and it is a significant infrastructure because all those streets are designed to, the stormwater goes through the streets, it goes into the drainage system, and then it goes into the golf course.
I didn't know that.
Yeah,
that's
problematic.
That's very interesting.
Now, the reason why you can do Faro Valley is...
It's kind of funny in a way.
Well, why?
Well, I don't know all this... the stormwater, right. You know, going into this place, and you're walking right there, you're thinking it's all green and all that.
I would tell you, I was at an engineering, talking about funny, I was in an engineer's office about 5 years ago. It's 6 o'clock on a Friday night. Every one of my friends is somewhere having a nice drink, and we're talking about wastewater issues.
There you go.
And it dawned on me, I know way too much. You know, I'm way too deep.
I don't think the average person is going
right.
to know that.
That's my point, is you start talking about wastewater, and people go, I didn't know that.
But, I mean, it makes sense. I don't know how else they could keep the places watered.
Right. And that's what you want. You want to collect that water. You use that water. And that means you spend less on buying city water. Now, one of the things that could help that course, by the way, is the city is building the Fluent Line, which is recycled water, a Fluent Line to the course. Right now, the course, if you own the golf course today, you would be buying water at the
right,
potable water.
Right.
Right. And so we're going to put that line in and we'll debate.
So it might be more economically viable once you do that.
You spend $400,000 in water today. If I sell you this affluent at a fourth of the price, so then you only spend $100,000. That really makes a dent in the bottom line.
Wasn't there some sort of controversy, too, about selling one of these golf courses or part of the golf courses to the major, to that A&M Texas
Corpus.
A&M?
Yeah.
What happened on that too?
I actually advocated for that and lost.
What was the deal on that? We decided not to.
The idea is the university was growing and said, guys, when we get to 10,000 students, we're capped. If we don't have land,
right.
And the land was really to move the parking lots off the island so they could build buildings on the island to handle the growth. They need land. They came to the city and had breakfast with Henry Garrett and I years and years ago. And we said, what do you want? You know, we're here for you. What do you want? And they said, well, we want to make a pitch for the golf course. And the concept at the time was we would give them Oso Golf Course on Alameda. We, in turn, would go buy Pharaoh's, which was ailing and is now closed. And then we would put a bunch of money in Pharaoh's so it would be a really cool golf course. And we would do that to get the golfers to buy in.
Right.
Not a bad idea.
Sounds too complicated to work.
Well, it had a deed restriction, and people got, you know, people were saying, I learned to play golf on that. You can't take it away. Shame on you. Don't steal my golf course kind of stuff. So in the end, we gave them the baseball fields, which is a smaller footprint, and you watch 15, 20 years from now, they'll be back to the city out of land.
Well, the other thing that's been going on locally, and I don't really know if you don't have any much to do with it, but I'm sure it has an impact or has been discussed, is a big fracking, oil discovery, and all that.
You know, I serve on the Coastal Bend Regional Water Planning Group. Okay, it's a planning group set up by the state of Texas. And you'll get a kick out of this. We met this week, and we're going to look at adjusting our usage numbers, and one of them was mining. I.e. Las Brisas, and they said, who wants to work on that committee? I said, man, I've had enough of Las Brisas. Let somebody else go spend. So I did not volunteer for that committee, but I did volunteer for the fracking committee, because a couple things. One is cities up north of us, I didn't realize this, but they tell me that Three Rivers will not give you a permit to build a new house. No more new permits. No more permits.
They're so excited about the fracking.
They're tapped out. No, they don't have the infrastructure to put another water heater.
Oh,
meter.
I see.
They have water, but their processing system is not in place to handle all this growth. Fascinating that they have reached the point where, you know, you're a home builder and you build two homes a year and you're making money and you've been there 20 years. You probably built more this last year. But you come to the city and they go, can't do it. I can't give you a permit because I can't get water to your house. So just on the public infrastructure side, it's really significant what's happening in that Eagle Ford Shale play. The other one is the whole fracking issue, is the, you know, how much water they're going to have to use to frack, where's it going to come from, what they're doing with the leftovers. So I got an email yesterday that we set up a subcommittee meeting in the next couple weeks. So the city's not in on it. I'm aware of it because I serve on that regional water planning group, which is a cool group, by the way. Keep an eye on it.
I mean, that just, you know, I have to admit that some of the issues that you deal with as we're applying, I mean, I'm trying to read these minutes, you know.
Don't do that.
And I'm thinking, hey, this is pretty boring stuff, but I guess that's the day-to-day things that you do on city council.
Well, yeah. You know, most are, like I was looking at our agenda, it's probably 3 inches thick this week. The reality is we've got a good staff. Ron Olson, if you haven't had him on the show, you ought to. You'd be impressed with Ron.
Well,
he's developed, you know, we've got a lot of confidence in most.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Of that stuff. We trust him on, you know, 75%.
He's your new city manager.
Yeah,
right?
75%.
Everybody says he's an impressive guy because of the way he speaks and that he's not going to be playing games. He's going to be rather straightforward. I've heard that. I know that, but I wonder about one issue. He's a city manager. Why would we be getting assistant city manager who right now, Mr. Riggs is going to.
We were going to lose Troy.
He's only been there about 3 years, right?
Yeah, and he's been recruited by everywhere, including Louisville, where he came from.
Why are we going to lose him?
Just can't afford him. Here's the interesting note. Okay, Troy. I don't know what Troy makes. It's public information, but one of his assistant police chiefs left last week to take the police chief in South Lake. The city of South Lake, okay? He moved up there. It's a city of 100,000. His total package is $50,000 more than we pay Troy. Okay, so they're a third of the city, but he makes 50% more or 30% more than Troy makes. We were not going to be able to keep this guy in that capacity.
Because of money. So Chief Troy Riggs right now is going to take the assistant city manager position. So impliedly, he's going to be making more than he was as a police chief.
Right. And we have adjusted his career path. You know, right now, before this happened, he was on a career path to be a police chief here,
right,
and then probably a bigger city, and then the bigger city. And so we have changed. Now, if you get to know Troy, though, his gift really is management and communication. It's not, you know, he's a wonderful police officer, but his true gift is in leadership. And I think you can transfer those skills to another. Now, by the way, we did.
You think you can?
Well, in the day, we didn't.
Yeah, but that's a big jump of logic necessarily. I don't know what a vocational rehabilitation expert or whatever, or somebody who's.
But he'll ultimately be over.
How many city
police, fire, and EMS?
How many assistant city managers are there?
Well, we didn't add one. We have one retiring, and we bumped Troy. And then we'll adjust we have Troy, Oscar Martinez, Margie Rose, and Roland.
It sounds a little bit, I'm sorry.
Rudy Garza, so we have four. We'll have four ACMs.
It sounds a little bit like a lateral move, very similar to what, of course, with Carlos Valdez did with moving.
Yeah, I think Carlos wanted to get out of the electoral, politics and wanted to just be a lawyer.
Or maybe he reserved. Maybe he worked there long enough to get a pension, and now he's another double dipper.
I think he's got a pension.
Yeah.
You know, just as a side note, I will tell you, I did not vote for Carlos.
Is that right? That's interesting.
It was an 8-1 vote.
And why was that? Why didn't you vote for him at that time?
And I think I made a mistake overall. I think he's done a much better job than I anticipated. Let me tell you what my deal was. There's two types of things that your city attorneys do. One is given an hour or a day or a week, they go back and they research and they call people and they come up with opinions. But occasionally, they're called upon right then, right there, to give us an answer. You know, in the heat of the moment, do they have the legal background to go?
I don't know that you should be doing that, though.
If you go to city council meetings, there's a lot going on. They said, is that, you know, what's the answer, Mr. Valdez? Mm-hmm. And I've seen it over the years how our other city attorneys were called upon to give us and it's really just based on law. And if you were a city lawyer for 30 years, you'd go, actually, the law says X. I did not think Carlos could bring that to the table because he'd never been a city attorney.
Well, that's a legitimate point. He couldn't.
Right. And so my fear was
of that area of law.
In that moment of need, in that moment, you know, would you be able to bring in that depth of history and knowledge and give an answer?
But I'm also glad to hear that you voted against the consensus, because when I was looking through your minutes the last three times, it seems like pretty much everything's unanimous.
I think you think, you know, well, I mean, we have probably 40.
A lot of it is just funding, though, of
right.
course.
You know. There's probably 40 agenda items on this week's agenda, and probably 30 of them are, you know, to spend $25,000 to buy a new truck.
Well, you know what I was, I was looking through,
go ahead. But, you know, our budgets haven't been unanimous. I'm not sure it was unanimous. Maybe it was hiring Ron. We all speak our mind. I mean, Kevin Kieschnick and I tried to get something on the agenda a couple weeks ago and couldn't get support.
What did you try to get on the agenda?
We didn't like the way the municipal court committee was handling hiring the new municipal court judge.
Who is the new municipal court judge?
Yeah, I forgot the name. I'm not on that committee.
Too, and I
actually,
get over there occasionally.
We just hired a guy. We just promoted him from a part-time full-time. And in the end, he was way ahead of everybody else, way ahead of. But what Kevin and I wanted to do was to get the committee to brief the council, because that's our hire, not the committee's hire. It's the council's hire. And we were concerned that they were doing too much of our work on their own. What we thought should have happened was they had 20 people, they have a system, they get it down to 7, then they go through another system and get it down to some number 3. They would submit those 3 to the city council, and then we would interview the 3 mm-hmm. and pick one. And where they were going was they were going to do all that work, pick mm-hmm. one, and come to us with the one. And that's ultimately what they did. But we had David Loeb was in the, and he was not on the committee, but he was in the interviews and said, guys, David agreed with us, but he said at the end of the day, this guy was just way ahead of everybody else. So we didn't fight that much. You know, that's an example of how
that's
Kevin and I
good
were.
Because like when I interview for somebody, I have like no idea.
Yeah, well,
this, I have no idea who to hire. I have no, you know.
Well,
I
this
know,
guy did
maybe
fantastic.
Maybe it's the way I think, you
yeah.
know.
And I actually, I cheer the administrative committee at the council. We have two committees. We have the city council. Then underneath it, we have two operating committees. There's the municipal court, who I just talked about.
Right.
Then there's the admin committee, and I chair that. So my depth of knowledge on the municipal court committee is not that great. I can tell you a lot about what the admin committee does. For instance, we processed the new city auditor and shepherded that process along. But for instance, mm-hmm. in that instance, we started with 10 names. We whittled it down to some there. We whittled it down to 3. Then we got the council together, and all of the council members interviewed the 3.
Who was the last city auditor?
We closed that department in 2000.
Why'd you close it in 2000?
I tell you, just, and obviously the citizens disagree with me. My theory is, if you hire the right CEO, you don't need an internal auditor. You need an external auditor every year, which we have.
What's an internal auditor do?
They go and they analyze cash accounts to make sure somebody's not stealing money from the cash. They will audit our utilities department to make sure that, you know, the steps are in place to collect money in the most economic means. But yeah. For instance, that's what I want. I would expect my city manager to do that. I would look to Ron and say, Ron, I see in the budget we spent, you know, $100,000, figure out a way to do it for
now. I know the Taxpayers Association, et cetera, never thought that was a good idea to get rid of the city auditor.
Right, and they're the ones that led the charge, or one of the ones that got it. And I didn't agree with it, but we put it to a vote. Citizens passed it. And so the admin committee shepherded the process to create this. And it's really been interesting. It's not easy to create a new municipal department. You know, you got to come up with the ordinances.
How much is the city auditor making? Do you know?
I think we're paying her $95,000.
I mean, that wouldn't seem to be a lot of money to be looking at the budget of a city.
$700 million, right.
And it would seem like you would think that a person like that would be able to save that much money.
That's our hope. And I've talked to her. In fact, you ought to have her on the show. You'd find her interesting. Celia. I've talked to her about that. You know, that in the end, that's what we think. We're going to spend $275,000 in that department. And it's my hope, and I think it's the citizens' expectation, that at the end of the year, we save $300,000. So it was an economic benefit. She would tell you that there's three parts. One is that you need to know somebody is looking over somebody's shoulder, which should give comfort. Two is that you do find savings where they are. But the third one is that you may do an audit, and in the end of that audit, you may say, Mr. DiCarlo, there was really nothing to be saved. They're doing it to the best. You know, they've got the system that's in place. So we may end up through some of these audits and go, you know what, there aren't any savings, or the savings are minimal. I don't think she would submit to you that we should not expect that every audit's going to result in significant savings.
Well, that's what I would imagine.
That's what I thought too.
I mean, that's what I would imagine, but nonetheless, I think it's kind of like running a business. It's got to be run in a business-like manner, whether or not you can necessarily say, you know, somebody has to be watching the show. If you open a satellite office somewhere, you just don't let people do whatever they want to do. You have to have some sort of structure, and I had thought, that's my opinion. I don't know that much about it.
Well, the city manager has formed a continuous improvement team that's designed to kind of work through the system and find better ways to, you know.
Who's our city manager?
Ron Olson.
And Ron Olson's relatively new, right?
Yeah, he came to us in June.
Where did he come from?
He came to us from Des Moines, Iowa. He was the manager of the county of whatever that is in Des Moines, big county. His city experience was in Arlington. He'd spent a number of years in Arlington.
So let's see here. Do you have any upcoming elections?
Their next set of elections are in November of next year.
You going to run again?
I do not know, Mark. I really don't.
You do not know. Okay.
I'm not prepared to answer that question.
At least you
today.
Came on here and told the citizens something.
I hope so.
Thank you very much.
I've enjoyed our time.
I guess someone talked, right? Thank you. Good night.